My son tied the knot. He got shipped off to Africa, leaving me alone with his young and gorgeous wife, Emily Chin. Living together as a single older man and a beautiful young woman? Yeah, you just know the neighborhood gossip mill was gonna start churning. I actually thought about moving out, but my son was totally adamant. He kept insisting I watch over Emily like a hawk. But hey, he seems to have forgotten that I'm still a man, and well, I've been single for a while now. I lost my wife years ago and became the town's longtime widower. It took everything I had, literally dropping 200 grand, to bring Emily home as my daughter-in-law last year. She's a college grad, drop-dead gorgeous, and super hardworking. The neighbors kept saying my son hit the jackpot, like his ancestors must have blessed him from the grave. And honestly, I totally agree. I mean, my kid didn't even finish high school, and we're definitely not rolling in cash. Landing someone like Emily? Man, that's pure luck. My son, Jason Chin, works construction and travels for business constantly, gone for 2 or 3 months at a stretch. This time, he's heading to Africa to work on some road project. When Emily found out, oh boy, did she lose it. She was ready to march down to the courthouse and file divorce papers. But Jason stood firm, telling us, "Dad, honey, this is my big break. I can't miss this opportunity. I support the kid." He just turned 30, has been grinding at construction sites for a decade, and finally got a shot at moving up. But Emily was heartbroken. She came crying to me, "Dad, tell me, does Jason really have to go?" I tried calming her down, playfully scolding Jason just to make her feel better. When I joked about them both going, Jason quickly shut that down, said the construction site was no place for a lady. So there I was, scratching my head, not sure what else to do. I just decided to get out of the house and clear my mind. When I got back home later, the young couple seemed to have made up. But from their bedroom, I could hear some interesting sounds. "Honey, keep it down," Emily whispered. "Dad might be home." My face turned bright red. I quickly realized what was going on and decided to head upstairs, hoping they'd soon give me a grandkid to spoil. 3 days later, Jason packed his bags for Africa. Before leaving, he grabbed me by the shoulders and said, "Dad, while I'm gone, keep an eye on Emily. Don't let anyone in the village mess with her." Previously, with Jason constantly traveling, it was just Emily and me at home. The neighborhood gossip started their usual chatter. Now with Jason's warning, moving out was out of the question. I tried to minimize our interactions to protect Emily's reputation. I started leaving early, coming home late, and even skipping meals at home. The gossip definitely died down. But one night, rolling in around 2 a.m., I heard some strange sounds coming from Emily's room. A soft hum. Made me pause. Worried I'd misheard, I inched closer. The sound only got more intense. I froze, my legs feeling like lead. Emily was always such a reserved woman, hardly spoke to anyone, and definitely didn't have close male friends. How could she be doing this? The sounds were unmistakable to anyone who's been around the block. No way. If I was wrong, I'd be the most embarrassed father-in-law in town. Just as I was about to turn and leave, another sound came from a room, louder this time. Curiosity got the better of me. I peeked through the door crack, catching only a glimpse of Emily's slender back. Nothing else was visible. Maybe I was overthinking it? Perhaps she was just missing Jason and coping in her own way? Confused, I retreated to my room. For some reason, sleep evaded me that night. My mind started wandering, spinning wild theories. Before marrying into the Chin family, Emily had plenty of good suitors. But she'd chosen Jason without hesitation, and they married less than a year after dating. The weird part? She didn't work, but her spending was through the roof, way beyond what Jason could afford on a construction worker's salary. Oh God, could she really have someone on the side? The seed of doubt was planted. From that point on, I started paying more attention to Emily. We ended up spending more time together, doing chores, hanging out, exactly the opposite of what I'd intended to avoid. Little did I know how deep this rabbit hole would go. The neighbors kept teasing us, "You two are closer than actual father and daughter. Your relationship's so tight, it's driving everyone crazy." I just brushed off their comments and continued my investigation. Then came the day I caught Emily sneaking into the woods with some guy, carrying two big somethings. I wanted to call Jason, but my phone was out of service. So, I did what any suspicious father-in-law would do. I followed them. Emily and the guy were close enough that I could barely make out my name in their conversation. Wait, could this be someone I know? Well, I was lost in thought. Emily had already set up her phone and stripped off her jacket. Holy moly, talk about a killer body. She started swaying her hips provocatively in front of the guy. Is she making money like this? I had seen those short video live streamers, barely dressed, making cash by streaming and giving special perks to their top fans. No wonder she could afford all those packages without working. I lost it. Bursting out, I pointed and shouted, "Emily, what in the world are you doing?" She looked shocked, quickly covering herself. "Dad, let me explain. It's not what you think." I wasn't having any of her excuses. I yanked the guy's arm, desperate to see who this homewrecker was. And then, plot twist, it was someone I knew way too well. My cousin, Tommy Wang, the village's notorious bachelor. This guy was infamous for sweet-talking his way into countless women's lives. He'd been living off our family's generosity for years, and now he's hitting on his own nephew's wife? Oh, hell no. I didn't waste a second. We started wrestling right there in the woods. Emily was screaming, "Dad, uncle, stop fighting." Tommy was running around, yelling, "Bro, hear me out. I'm working, I swear." Years of farming had kept me strong. I chased Tommy through the trees while he begged for mercy. Emily, terrified someone might get seriously hurt, finally stopped me. Tears streaming, she pleaded, "Dad, you're totally misunderstanding." I ignored her, coldly saying, "You can explain everything to Jason." Worried Jason might lose it, Emily dropped to her knees, clutching my leg. "Dad, believe me. I've done nothing wrong to Jason." That's when I finally calmed down and looked closer. Emily was dressed provocatively, but not indecently. Tommy looked like he was cosplaying some D-list celebrity, seriously ugly. Two phones were set up, one live streaming, one recording video. Emily checked her phone and suddenly looked stunned. "Dad, uncle, we've gone viral." Turns out people these days are bored and love drama. Our little catching a cheater scene had blown up. In just 5 minutes, her live stream was popping, with viewers sending gifts and asking for updates. Tommy was over the moon. Always living off family handouts, he saw this as a payday. "Niece-in-law," he said, "you're not keeping all these gifts, right?" I took a beating. Emily, totally bewildered, mumbled, "Don't worry, uncle. I'll give you your share." I knew Tommy was bad news. So I doubled down, shouting, "What are you playing at? Trying to mess with my son and now extort money?" Tommy Wong immediately got defensive, jumping around. "Bro, my niece-in-law said we're working, so I deserve payment." Emily avoided my gaze, her eyes welling up with tears. I knew something was up. Her personality wasn't the type to voluntarily involve a sleaze-all like Tommy unless he had some serious leverage. Seeing his smug face, I confirmed my suspicions and warned him, "Tommy, my son's got a temper you don't want to mess with. If he finds out, you'll be in deep trouble. Now scram." Just as I expected, Tommy tucked tail and ran. To avoid neighborhood gossip, I didn't grill Emily on the spot. Instead, I coldly told her, "Put your coat on. We'll talk at home. Don't give these people a show." I stormed home, Emily trailing behind. Half an hour later, she burst through the door and dropped to her knees. Silent tears, clutching my pants leg, anyone watching would think I'd committed a crime. Worried the neighbors might hear, I tried to calm down. "Emily, what the hell happened today?" Wiping her tears, she sobbed, "Dad, I was trying to make some money streaming. But uncle, he's a monster. He forced me to film those videos." I was furious but confused. Tommy? Actively causing trouble? No way he'd dare mess with our family. Clearly, she wasn't telling the whole truth. I softened my tone, probing carefully, "Emily, what are all these equipment purchases about?" Her face changed. After much hesitation, she finally admitted, "Dad, I'll be honest. I'm doing that kind of streaming." It hit me like a thunderbolt. I wasn't some dinosaur. I knew about these streams. But seeing your own daughter-in-law? Totally different ballgame. Emily saw my shock and begged, "Please, Dad, don't tell Jason. I'm desperate." She explained her family was broke. Her brothers were getting married, and her parents were counting on her. Streaming seemed the quickest way to make money. Jason had mentioned her complicated family situation before, but I never imagined they'd pile such pressure on her. After much thought, I decided to keep her secret. So began a strange new routine. Emily would stream nightly, sometimes asking me if her outfit looked appropriate. Thankfully, she wore different masks and changed backgrounds to avoid recognition. One day, while bringing in her packages, I heard a scream from the bathroom. Panicking, I called out, "Emily, are you okay?" Silence. Just some crashing sounds. Was she unconscious? Just as I was about to call the neighbor, I heard Emily's desperate cry. "Dad, help me." I burst through the door. Steam everywhere. Emily sat on the floor, staring horrified at the open window. "Uncle." Uncle tried to. "Dad, you have to help me." She wailed, grabbing a towel and covering herself. Rage boiling over, I charged to the kitchen, ready to beat Tommy to a pulp. I hadn't even left the living room when I heard another loud thud behind me. Deliberately averting my eyes, I asked, "Emily, did you fall? Are you okay?" Her voice trembled. After several attempts, she embarrassedly pleaded, "Dad, I think I've twisted my ankle. Can you help me up?" I slowly approached, making sure she was decently covered before extending my hand to help her up. Emily blushed, leaning into my chest. "Thank goodness you're here," she whispered. "I'd be lost without you." Because of her sprained ankle, our physical interactions increased unexpectedly. I started handling the cooking and housework. But things got weird. Whether intentionally or not, Emily would leave her intimate clothing in conspicuous places for me to toss in the washing machine. I was old, after all. I didn't think much of it. Until that stormy night when Emily knocked on my door. I was lying in bed, phone volume up. Didn't hear her knocking. Another thunderclap roared. Before I could react, she burst in, diving into my arms. "Dad, I've always been terrified of thunder." Her hot breath on my chest, her hair brushing my nose, I felt completely uncomfortable. I pushed her away, standing up quickly. "It's okay. Let me walk you back to your room." Maybe because of the thunder, she didn't hear me. She kept clinging to me, her fingers moving restlessly. I felt something stirring, but quickly regained my composure and rushed her downstairs. Seeing her still shaken, I tried to comfort her. "Emily, call me if you need anything." But before I could turn away, she grabbed my arm. Bashfully, she asked, "Daddy, you've been sending gifts in my live stream. Don't you want some? Special treatment?" I was stunned, practically fleeing the room. I'd been trying to help her by sending anonymous donations, which she'd previously refused. But somehow, she'd figured out it was me. The next few days, Emily acted completely normal, maintaining her distance as if that night was just a dream. I overheard Jason calling her, "Honey, I'm ready. Come on." The thin walls revealed sounds. Sounds I shouldn't be hearing. Worse, inappropriate images started flooding my mind. Her thin nightgown, her moving hips. I shook my head, apologizing to myself for such terrible thoughts. Then I heard Emily's angry whisper, "That old bastard still hasn't taken the bait." Suddenly alert, I crept closer to her room to eavesdrop. But they were too engrossed in their video to continue the conversation. At dinner, Emily kept making weird movements under the table, staring intensely. I ignored her, wondering about their potential scheme. While I was distracted, she suddenly bent down, leaving me frozen and confused. Then she sweetly asked, "Daddy, we're so compatible. Why don't you marry me?" I pushed her away. "Are you crazy? Our age difference? This never happened. Don't bring it up again." I immediately went to the notary, redistributing my assets and adding specific conditions to my will. Jason had always wanted to be his own boss, but I knew he lacked business skills. The assets would be his after my death, but he'd been eyeing my money for years. I was shocked. For money, he'd actually pimp out his own wife to seduce me, willingly wearing the metaphorical cuckold's horns. When I exposed their plot, they shed crocodile tears. But it was too late.